They were extremely dominant. I mean, we knew what we were getting into, that's for sure.
I got a little nervous at the end there, I guess, in the seventh. I'm like, you know, is this going to really happen or not?
I think it definitely kind of lit a fire under her, you know, knowing that she probably should have made it.
Tincture has retired 16 in a row.
Did I go in there and think we were going to be the USA team? I got to be honest with you, no.
The last loss from Team USA coming back in 1996 against California Select.
She had nothing to lose, but she had everything to prove that, hey, I deserve to be in that uniform too.
They had won two gold medals back to back.
Crystal Bustos, the batter. The only base runner she has allowed thus far, a one-out walk to Kelly Kretschmann in the second. Trying to no-hit Team USA.
It was such an experience, no matter what happened. It was going to be something that we were going to remember forever. I would say we had a pretty competitive household, but mostly just a stubborn household. I was very stubborn, so was my dad. So to tell us that you can't do something wasn't really an option. We were going to try to figure out a way to make it happen. I was pretty undersized as a pitcher, but I still knew I wanted to throw the same speed as everybody else. So we just decided to figure out how to make it work. I would throw to my dad a lot, and he was on the bucket. And like I said, we knew that we were just figuring it out as we went, so I didn't necessarily think he was an expert yet. So I would challenge a lot of the things that he said, or I would try to find a better way to do it. So there were definitely several practices where my mom had to say, if you guys can't play nice, you're not going to get to keep doing this. But it was all in fun. It was just us trying to figure out the best way to make me successful. I transferred to James River High School my sophomore year, so I played there for the final 3 years. And I was pretty successful in high school, but we were also a very small high school. So even though I was striking a lot of people out and having a lot of success, it didn't necessarily translate to what colleges were looking for, because you weren't sure what the opponents were like. So we won back-to-back state titles, which was really exciting for us. But again, we were still the smallest distinction of high schools in the state. So that wasn't necessarily something that I could use as a recruiting tool. I still had to have the travel ball in the summer to get myself out there.
You know, Angela was a little bit of a hidden commodity. I mean, really, actually very hidden commodity. She came out of a small high school. She'd played on a team that didn't do a lot of traveling extensively. When we were watching her, the one question was, who else is looking at her? Which we do that with every recruit, you know, is who else is involved? And it kind of just got to the point where we were realizing that she's pretty overlooked.
I think the only other person that really gave her some attention and they dropped off, I believe, was Georgia Tech. And I'm not sure why other schools didn't see it. I think it was because she played for a small school in high school and not a big name summer ball team.
As the story goes, we had about a half scholarship, and I said, I told Al Bronze at the time, I said, I think we can get her for half. And he said, why do you think that? And I was like, I said, because I don't think anybody else is going to offer.
Oddly enough, they had a pickup team. And at the end of her senior year in high school, they had a pickup team to play the USA team.
She played for me as part of a Salem All-Star team. And I think she pitched the state championship game maybe the week or two before. And then we had her pitching in the this All-Star game that we put together. So the national team was touring, and her first batter that she faced was Stacy Newman, who was the big catcher, and she struck her out on three pitches.
This was on the Aiming for Athens tour. Then an 18-year-old Angela Tincture striking out Newman on three pitches, and I love that reaction. As if to say, what did I just do?
And I was like, this is going to be kind of fun.
Coach Thomas called me right away and said, I think we got something right here. And she's never let us down.
I had really no idea what to expect when I first got here. I knew that I felt like I could make an impact and I could be a starter pretty soon, but I just really didn't know. It was overwhelming. But I knew I really wanted to fight for that starting role. So that's what my whole freshman year, I was just really trying to prove myself and make sure that I was going to get some time to be out there on the field.
Yeah, it's kind of funny. She really never really showed that give me the ball type person. It was okay, I'm gonna go out here and do my job. She was always about getting it done and being a master of her craft. Tell when she needed to crank it up a little bit, she could do that.
Her ball moves like, it's like I said, it's like magic. I mean, you see that ball, there it is, and you'd swing, and all of a sudden it wasn't there. I mean, it was incredible. And she had several pitches. She was always known for a rise ball, but I'll tell you, her drop was as good as anybody in the country.
Kind of learned as she went to roll with the punches sometimes, and by senior year, I think that competitive edge was there, always there, but it wasn't as maybe aggressive early on.
I don't know if I ever had a moment where I really felt like it was clicking. I think the first game that I got to pitch my freshman year, I still remember, you just don't know until you're out there how things are going to go. And I did pretty well and we won, and I had a lot of strikeouts, but I also gave up the home run. So I knew I still had some work to do and I didn't really feel satisfied. My first step was getting to be our starter, but then I didn't really want to just stop there. My first interaction with the national team was after my sophomore year, I believe, in college. So that would have been 2006. I had the opportunity to try out for their university team. The actual tryouts for the Olympic team was in the summer of 2007. For the most part, they would just throw all the athletes that had been invited all out together. I felt like I did pretty well. I was out there against some of the best athletes in the country, so I definitely gave up some hits, but I also had some big outs, and I felt like I was measuring up, so I was trying to be optimistic about where I stood in the tryout process, but I also knew who else was going against me were the best pitchers in the world, and they were doing well too. So I felt like I was right up there with them, but being a little bit younger, I probably would have had to do even a lot better than they did.
She actually wasn't on the list to begin with, which was really kind of shocked me. So I made some phone calls and was like, you know, you got people on here. I'm not saying at the time they had Jenny Fish, they had Kat Osterman, they had Monica Abbott. I knew that there were going to be like three pitchers, and the face of USA softball was Jenny Finch at that time. And then you got these two big lefties and Monica Abbott, Kat Osterman. I knew they probably would be carrying probably Lisa Fernandez again. So the chances of her making that team was not great, but given the tryout list and she wasn't on it and there were some other pitchers that were, I was like, this is crazy.
I think I knew throughout the tryout it would be really hard for me to make that team just because of what veterans that they had returning to the pitching circle. I'd crunched the numbers. I was hoping maybe if they took one more pitcher, that's really what it came down to. I kind of knew who the set pitchers would be, but I was hoping they'd keep one more on the roster than what they normally did, or for that year, it would work out in my favor. So that's what I was hoping for, and when I saw how the numbers worked out, I kind of understood.
I think it was an oversight on their part a little bit, but again, they had three dominating pitchers anyway, and I understand that piece of it. I just think that Angela was just as good.
Yeah, I was definitely disappointed that I didn't make the team, but I knew I had a great fallback, and that was coming back to Virginia Tech. You know, I'd always hoped to be able to take an Olympic red shirt, but that doesn't happen for many people, so I knew that worst case scenario, I'd still be here for my senior year. We had a great team coming back, so those were all good things. And then I could just turn my focus back to being here and doing the best that I could for that final year.
It might have fueled her. It might have fueled her fire going into the 2008 season. You know, knowing that she probably should have made it, but didn't. Wasn't given the opportunity. I think it definitely kind of lit a fire under her to have a finish off with a good season and go from there.
We actually in December, beginning of December, I got a phone call from ASA, and they said, "Hey, look, we're gonna bring DePaul and Northwestern in here to play Team USA here in Oklahoma City," and as it worked out, Northwestern couldn't work it out with their schedule, and the guys out there called me up and said, "Hey, would you be interested?" And I said, "Hey, yeah, pencil us in. I got to get permission here first, and is there anything you can do for us from a financial standpoint? We've already spent our budget to have it already allotted." And they said they could help me out, and so I went up and talked to Jim Weaver, and I told him what the deal was. It was going to be the ESPN game, a nationally televised deal, and he didn't hesitate. He said, yeah, sure, do it, absolutely. I get down, call him back and say, we're on, let's do it. And so that's kind of how it was. We kind of came in the back door because Northwestern didn't want to play. And then that's how it got started.
We played them, Virginia Tech, we played them in 2004 also. And so we had kind of a relationship there with them. They also had another pickup team from this area come around, and we played them again. So overall, we've played them really about four times. So we had a relationship.
I think it's exciting. It's rare to get the opportunity to, in any of sports, to play a team that's really at a professional level. And not just that, but a team that is known for their gold medals. They kind of rule the softball world when it comes to the Olympics. And so when that opportunity was there, it's kind of like, all right, let's do it. Let's have some fun, you know.
What do you have to lose? You know, and what an excitement thing for the kids, you know, and for the university to get your name out, you know, you can't be embarrassed. I mean, you're playing the number one team in the world, so you can't be embarrassed. But the school and our program, we could get a lot out of it. And no, there was never even a doubt when we got the opportunity, we're playing.
As we got out there, my whole mindset was really one thing. Take a hard look around at this environment and being in Oklahoma City if you want to be back here again in a month or so or whatever it was to be back for the World Series. So I kind of used it as motivation from that standpoint and said, hey, look around, we can be right back here. This is our goal right now. And so I kind of used it as motivation. So I was kind of excited about it. I really wasn't worried about how it affected us from a, you know, pitch and piece in the middle of the season, that type of thing. I thought it was completely positive, and it certainly was.
At first, it's kind of overwhelming. You're like, oh my gosh, I'm going to pitch against this team, the best team in the world. But then I realized it also gave me a chance to kind of have some closure on the whole situation. So I partially dreaded it and partially really looked forward to it at the same time.
One of the powerhouse U.S. teams at this Olympics is women's softball. Back home, a lot of Major League Baseball players have made the mistake of thinking they could hit their underarm pitching. Here they are 6-0, all shutouts. They have made winning a science, in part because science has helped make them win.
I watched them, you know, in high school, and I remember thinking, I want to do that, you know, I want to be them. So, they're kind of like the giants of the softball world, if that makes sense.
Jessica Mendoza and Crystal Bustos were two that I feared probably the most because of their power. Every single girl on that team could hit it out of the park, but those girls took the biggest swings, and if they connected with the ball, it was probably going to go pretty far. So it was kind of like a big gamble, but you're hoping to make them miss big too.
4 years ago when we played them, Bustos hit a home run off of us that probably is the longest and highest ball I've ever seen hit in fast pitch softball. I believe it's still in orbit. I really do. I think it's circling the earth. They were extremely dominant. I mean, we knew what we were getting into, that's for sure.
I saw Bustos when she was at West Palm Beach Community College. Jenny Finch when she was like 14, 15 years old in a tournament up in Minneapolis. Go back through that list and I've probably had seen all of them, you know, from a standpoint of when they were an 18 and under ball. And then we played against some of them. It's pretty impressive to see these people and just how good they are at you know, the highest level of the game.
Did I go in there and think we were going to be the USA team? I got to be honest with you, no. I thought if we could keep it close and keep it and where we could play seven innings, that would be great. Well, I knew we weren't going to get blown out with Angela. I knew we would go seven innings, but if we could keep the game close, it would be great. It would be a victory for us.
I would have said, let's hope we hold our own and not embarrass ourselves.
I would have said, we're going to try to play seven innings with them.
I think I hoped to go out and put on a performance, but you also know this is the best team in the world, so I really just was focused on the three innings that I was supposed to pitch and doing the best that I could. And in my mind, I think getting out of there scoreless would have been a huge win.
She had nothing to lose, but she had everything to prove that, hey, if everything goes well, I deserve to be in that uniform too.
Welcome to ASA Hall of Fame Stadium here in Oklahoma City. Tonight, another pit stop on the KFC Bound for Beijing Tour. Team USA, they may have their hands full as they take on the pesky Hokies of Virginia Tech.
I don't remember exactly how I felt with my nerves before the game. I mean, I was definitely nervous because they were the best hitters I was going to face the entire year, but there also wasn't the same amount of pressure because we watched them beat DePaul the game right before us 23-0. So you're like, we can do better than that.
I remember Eugene Lenny from DePaul, as we were passing each other going off the field, he said, well, good luck. Said the good things is we got all the hits out of their bats.
Well, Team USA is very strong offensively, lots of power, lots of speed. And in the circle, they have great arms from both sides.
Well, in 2004, one of the pitchers was Jenny Finch. Jenny Finch is still around here in 2008. What's the difference with her?
Well, I think Jenny's rise ball is much better this year. She's really been working on driving that pitch low through the zone and high through the zone. And she understands that throwing a good changeup is going to be important as well.
She started playing ball, I know, at a very young age. And she certainly has that perfect build for a college or a fast pitch pitcher.
Jenny Finch had a lot of tools at her disposal, so she could throw a lot of different pitches in different zones and change speeds. I think her presence on the mound was also a huge benefit for her, both her height and her demeanor.
The biggest thing though for me was Ange telling me you can hit her, and knowing kind of going out there, you don't have anything to lose, you know, just get after it. That really kind of helped.
She was known world round, and through her college days and going to the World Series and winning national championships, and she was a celebrity back then. She was usually the big draw when it came. She was the picture of fast pitch softball for women.
I think at that time I would have considered her a celebrity. She was in a lot of magazines. She was had a lot of ads, a lot of sponsors. So she was someone that had a lot of exposure in the softball world and someone that had exposure beyond softball, which is something that softball hadn't really had. She had a lot of exposure in the celebrity world outside of even sports.
There's nothing but gold that this team will accept. Wearing this uniform means gold.
Well, they're in good spirits, the Virginia Tech Hokies. They think they've got a chance.
Oh, gosh, butterflies. But I had a coach tell me once that if you don't have butterflies, it's not worth it.
Angela Tincher, she is dynamic in that circle.
You know, I felt good. I felt confident in the sense that at least I was prepared. But I definitely didn't expect to do that well.
There she is. Yeah. We got Angela today.
And that's what she's all about. She gets a strikeout to begin the game.
Well, that's Ange. You know, we're thinking that's a great start, you know. To play a team like that and get by the first inning, that's the biggest thing. Now, Angela has all the confidence, and so getting by that first inning that easy, I think, was really extra for her.
That is a rarity. Team USA going down in order.
Once that first inning was under our belt, it kind of got into feeling like a regular game.
I'm thinking it's a great start, but there's still a lot of work to do. So I was trying not to relax because I still knew I had some of the hardest hitters in their lineup coming up.
All right, here, starting out the second inning, Kelsey Hoffman will bat. She's going to try and help her team with a bat in her hands against Jenny Finch.
She gave me a curveball, which is my favorite. I like that outside pitch, and it served up, took a swing, and there it went.
This ball is blooped into right field. It's going to get down and go all the way to the wall.
You know, getting to the bases. I think I was probably smiling the whole time I was running.
What a thrill for Kelsey Hoffman.
Big smile on Kelsey Hoffman's face. I'd be smiling, too, if I hit a double off of Jenny Finch.
I mean, I think it kind of sunk in. I just hit a double off Jenny Finch. Like, wow, okay, I can do this.
I just remember the excitement when we got our first hit off of them and then seeing the ball in the air and realizing we may also have a run. It was unbelievable.
Looking over the dugout, I think it gave everyone a sense of we can hit her. She's not a, you know, she's not going to bowl us over.
Jenny again getting called for an illegal pitch, which will move the runner up 60 feet.
Oh, that's a big advantage now. So a runner on at third, nobody out.
You know, was that one call a help? Yeah, I mean, to move a runner from second to third, which we were trying to do with the two batters prior, you always want to get that runner on to third. But She's always been had that problem of getting called for illegal pitches throughout her career, and it just shows how great she is because she pushed it to the hilt. You know, she got as close as she could, and then Caroline Stolle came up.
Case Jenny Finch is trying to play some mind games on Stolle. It's not going to work. She's got a 3-2 GPA in psychology. Ball is looped in the left field. It's going to get down. It'll score a run. And Virginia Tech is on the board.
Caroline came up and got that single, and Anna scored, and that was it.
This is foreign territory for Jenny Finch and Team USA. This is the first time this entire tour that they have trailed an opposing team.
You could always see it in the dugout. You can just that, what are we going to do? I don't know that they ever had that sense of we're out of it, because, I mean, it was just one run. You know, that's not enough to get out of a situation, you know. But I think they might have been a little shocked.
Yeah, I mean, I noticed it when the call was made where she went to third. But then when the run scored, you know, you could see a little bit, a little difference. And but she's a professional, and, you know, she held it tight, and she's been in those predicaments many times, and she's a professional, so she worked through it. We were a lot different. We were excited, man, and we were up on the fence, and we're cheering and going crazy.
And I'm just throwing it out here, but Angela Tincher is awfully good. If for some reason she can keep it on, this might be a very difficult evening for Jenny Finch, Stacey Newman, and the rest of Team USA.
Also, as a pitcher, you know that this is going to light a fire under their offense because they don't want to be behind. They don't want to give up runs to a college team. So that was going to make them even more motivated when they came out to hit. So, you know, I definitely couldn't relax because they were going to be even more focused.
Tincher is going to have to be great through seven innings against the most powerful offense in the entire world.
Angela Tincher in the circle against the dangerous Crystal Bustos.
That's the one that she accumulates so many strikeouts on.
Off the thumps. That was not a pleasant experience for Crystal Bustos. This is some history right here. Stacey Newman, if she remembers this 4 years ago, she has faced Tincher before and not enjoyed the experience. And again on three pitches, Tincher gets it done. Stacey Newman has struck out on three pitches twice in her life against Angela Tincher.
It gave me confidence that I was getting them to strike out because I knew there was still a little bit of a wiggle room as I threw the pitches if I was getting them to completely miss. And it also really helped for my game plan that they were being that aggressive, because that's exactly what I needed to be successful, is I needed them to be aggressive in chasing those pitches.
Swing and a miss, that's doing something. The top two batters in the game, Caitlin Lowe and Natasha Watley, have both struck out twice. The fact that Angela Tincher has not allowed a base hit, this is his story.
I think I knew throughout the game, obviously I hadn't given up any hits, but I would definitely not, wasn't ready to embrace the term no-hitter, because every inning that I got to go out there was just a bonus, and I knew if I did give up a hit, that would probably be it for my night.
Yeah, I knew it, and I mean, I thought about it. Certainly never talked about it. Nobody did. If they would have, we'd have kicked them out of the dugout.
Yeah, you don't talk about it. Mm-mm, not at all. I try not to even look at the scoreboard in that kind of situation if I even have a sense that it's going on.
The only thing that was said is Tiffany did say, you know, I'm assuming we're going to leave her in at this point. And I was like, absolutely. And just, it was never talked about again.
We're just trying to have some fun out there. It's, you know, it's a great environment, great opportunity for us. And girls just relax going out there and playing hard.
11 straight Team USA batters have been retired by Angela Tincher. There she is, pitching the game of her life. She needs just six more outs for arguably the biggest upset in the history of Team USA softball.
I don't think I thought about any of the things like their resume or what was going into it, because you couldn't. I never considered winning this game. It just seemed like something that was so out of reach. I think I get more stressed now as a coach than I did in those moments, because I felt in control and felt like I had something that I could control there.
Two strikes to Flowers. Nine punch outs for Tincher.
I'm telling you, she's an incredible woman. And she was like that her whole career. Far beyond her years.
Nine times. And this one's going to stay on the infield, and it's caught. A 1-2-3 sixth inning. Angela Tincher has now retired 14 in a row. And Team USA, they're only going to have three more outs to try and get in this game.
It was a blur. Every inning that went by was a blur, but it was just so much fun, too. It was a stage that we hadn't got to play on with the television and with the people that were playing against, those athletes. So it was such an experience, no matter what happened. It was going to be something that we were going to remember forever.
The scheduled batters for Team USA, Natasha Watley, Jessica Mendoza, and Crystal Bustos, 2, 3, and 4 in Team USA's lineup. It doesn't get any more difficult than that. That's arguably the finest bunch of hitters that you're ever going to see in the international game. And they're going to hit down by one, trying to stave off not only a loss, but a no-hitter. Swing and a miss. Monica Abbott strikes out the side. All right, the moment of truth is upon us. Angela Tincher with history awaiting. She's got a no-hitter going, trying to beat Team USA. You're not going to want to miss this, folks.
When you're playing a team like that, there's always going to be one inning that they could just take over. I mean, there's always that case. And we got up to inning 7 and had, I think it was maybe batters 2, 3, and 4 in their lineup. So we finished with Bustos, who could single-handedly send one over.
I knew I still had to take them one batter at a time. I couldn't look past Watley and Mendoza and look at Bustos because Watley could hit the ball out of the park too.
Talk about a white-knuckle situation. Angela Tincher has retired 14 in a row. She has struck out 9. And she starts Watley off with a strike.
With Natasha up first, knowing the speed that she had, if she placed the ball at all, I knew she had a chance of getting on base.
Softly hit to third. Out at first base, Maraconda gets Watley by a whisker.
I don't think there's any way that you could look at the out that Sharice Maraconda pulled with Natasha Watley and getting her by a quarter step. There's nothing bigger than that, because my thought was, you know, it just takes that one batter on, and then you're starting to look up at Jessica Mendoza and Crystal Bustos, who can absolutely crush a ball. And you sit there and you look at, you know, bloop and a bomb, game's over with.
So when she hit that ball to Sharice, and Sharice made one of the best plays she's ever made to get her out, I knew we had a shot, we had one out, and we kept the table setter off base. But it just still gave me so much confidence to see the way that my team was playing and the way the defense was playing behind me. It was not just what I was doing in the circle, but just to have that amount of composure and be able to execute under pressure for everyone that was involved, all 9 of us that did it. I thought it was amazing.
Jessica Mendoza comes up empty.
Angela Tincher has pitched tonight like she's had something to prove. I'm sure a part of her felt like she had the resume to be wearing that red, white, and blue for an opportunity to go to Beijing.
One of the last cuts during the Olympic tryouts. Mendoza down in the count, a ball and 2 strikes. For all intents and purposes, Angela Tincher could have said to her outfield, "I don't need you today." A ball has not been hit by Team USA past the infield yet. And we have 1 out in the 7th. Called strike 3!
Mendoza chased up, and then I believe we froze her on a low rise for a backwards K, and she went straight to the dugout. She didn't argue at all.
Yeah, I mean, I got to admit it. I mean, I don't know, Coach Thomas may sit here and tell you he was calm as he can be, and he may have been. I don't think he was, but man, I was nervous.
I wasn't really never that nervous, because there wasn't anything to be nervous about. There was really nothing on the line, per se. I got a little nervous at the end there, I guess, in the 7th, and like, you know, is this going to really happen or not?
Even though we got through those first 2 hitters, it was nerve-wracking to get to Crystal.
The only base runner she has allowed thus far, a 1-out walk to Kelly Crutchman in the 2nd.
Mendoza and Bustos were, honestly, I think they were trying too hard.
I get pretty involved during a game anyway, and I don't care who we're playing or what the score is. I get pretty involved, but I got to be honest. I mean, there was something about that day, that game, that was different. In its own way, it was different.
Coming in at 68 miles an hour.
Off the thumbs, this is going to do it. Virginia Tech, they win against Team USA, and it's all Angela Tincher. She throws a no-hitter.
probably Cal, we won.
Man, yeah, including me. I mean, I was just like the girls, running out there in a circle and hugging everybody and being the coach you're not supposed to be. You're supposed to act like, you know, you do this all the time. And not me. I gotta tell you, I was so happy, and I was high as a kite.
I think when we got the final out, it was still a blur, because it was still like, did it really happen? You hoped that it could happen, and the closer we got to the final out, you felt like we had a shot. But just to see it pop up in the infield and that be it, I don't think it ever sunk in.
Congratulations. It was a heck of a game to watch you throw.
Thank you. It was fun, to say the least.
You looked like you're having a great time. Talk to us about some of the pitches you were throwing. What was working for you tonight?
I felt like everything was working today. I used my rise and my drop off, obviously, a whole lot, and I mixed the changeup in there a little bit. But, you know, Kelsey did a great job keeping them off balance. Obviously, that's a hard team to do that with, and she did a great job.
I was interested to see what the response was going to be of the USA players, really. And most of them were very gracious, and we took a big picture, you know, at the end of the game and together with the scoreboard behind us. And that had to be, for as competitive as that caliber of athlete is, that had to be hard to do, you know, to have that scoreboard on behind them with us having one to nothing with no hits on their board.
As much of a win that was for us, it was just as big, in a sense. It's not the Olympics, but in a sense, a loss to their pride or whatever. And they were as gracious as they could be. We wanted to ask them if they would do a team picture with us and them, and there was absolutely no hesitation. They were wonderful about it. Yeah, they were so gracious in that defeat. They really were.
I remember that they talked for a very long time. They had a really long meeting, and we were also excited, taking pictures of the scoreboard. We probably didn't help matters a whole lot, but there was also an autograph session after the game, and we were paired up with different players and all stationed out in the outfield, and they were polite, but they weren't excited, obviously. But they still behaved like adults and were very courteous to us, and a couple of them came up and complimented us on the game, which really meant a lot, even in that moment, that they could say things like that. It boosted our confidence.
By the time we got back to the hotel, I think most of us were on like 3-4 hours of sleep, so it was a pretty uneventful plane ride back. It was that bus ride, because we flew to Charlotte, so we bussed back. And then once you kind of hit the town limits, we were escorted in. That's pretty cool. And we actually had a group of people waiting for us, like, you know, kind of like the football team does. So it was kind of neat.
Well, you know, for those girls, my God almighty, I mean, what excitement, you know, for them to have a police escort, you know, bring you in and you get off the bus and all these people are there and hugging them and congratulating them. And like I said, I'm still a kid, man. I enjoyed that. Even as an old man who's a coach, I enjoyed that. But for those girls, that's something they will never, ever, ever forget.
Leaving that game and winning, of course, is a huge celebration, but we knew it was back to the books. We had to, you know, still put the hard work in, because that wasn't the season. That wasn't the end goal. The end goal was to get to regionals, then to super regionals, and if the World Series if possible.
As we told the girls, you know, they're not going to give us any rings for beating the USA team. We've got bigger fish to fry here and more goals. And in fact, some people have always said, is that the greatest day of, you know, but it really wasn't. The greatest day was probably in Ann Arbor later that year on that Sunday. We had to beat Michigan back-to-back, you know, beat them 2 games on that Sunday to make it to the World Series. That was probably the greatest day, and I was probably way more excited there than I was after the Oklahoma game, because we had so much more riding on it.
Winning the USA game kind of goes down in history. When people ask us, like, that know about that game, that's usually what I hear about first, not the World Series.
From a professional experience, there's nothing higher in my life than that could have been. It was, I mean, I've had a lot of different professions and had some exciting things in my life, but that's something that stands right at the top.
I think the game meant a lot to me personally, from wanting to be on the Olympic team, not getting to, feeling like I had some closure. It meant a lot to me personally, but then as a team, it also meant a lot to all of us, because it gave us a lot of confidence to finish out that season, and it made us feel like we really belonged and we really could hang with some of the top teams in the country. To see your team fight in that situation, score runs, play great defense, I felt really confident and really thankful for the players that I was playing with as well.